Now, black paint is one of those colours which is sometimes shunned upon within the watercolour world. So today I'm going to give you some ideas on how to make your own blacks using both three or even two colours from your mixing palette. Let's make a start. Okay, I'm going to go for, let's have a look, Scarlet Lake, phthalo blue and lemon yellow. Now, the one I've just done off camera is Scarlet Lake, ultramarine blue and lemon yellow. So let's see what the differences might be. Depending on how much of each colour that you add will depend on the colour that you get. Obviously, of course it will. So lemon yellow first of all. I'm going to go for, let's go for Scarlet Lake. Try that one, okay? Whoa, look at that. Look at that. That's nearly orange. I know, that's like a deep orange, isn't it? So we'll try that one. Wash your brush out in the dirty and then in the clean. And then we're going to go for the phthalo blue. If you haven't got a phthalo blue, you can use Windsor blue instead. See, that's quite brown, isn't it? Very brown looking colour. But that's okay. It's okay. It's getting there. So wash the brush out. Get some more phthalo blue in there. Now you have to remember that when you wash that brush out as well, very often you get water in this metal ferrule. And that will run down that ferrule inside the ferrule, through the bristles, and dilute the paint even more within your mixing well. So now that's turned more like a deep bluey green, isn't it? Not a very attractive colour, I have to say. So wash that out again. And go back to the Scarlet Lake. Add that one in just a little bit. You'll also find that some pigments that you use tend to be stronger than others. For example, phthalo blue is a very strong colour. So that particular one is quite rich, isn't it? That's like a deep, reddy, purpley colour on there. So if we try that again with some more phthalo blue, and pop that in, just try it there, look. What's that like? Look at the difference that's made already. So that's now more on the blue side, isn't it? As you can see. Mix it all the way in now. And that's getting darker. As I say, every layer that you add, every layer will get darker and darker and darker. So back to lemon yellow, pop a little bit more of that in there. And that's turned it more to a greeny shade. There you go. So you can see from those three testers there, the middle one with more the phthalo blue works better with this particular mix. You also have to remember as well that some of the blacks will stain the paper. So if you need to use a lifting off technique, then I'll suggest you do this to test out all the different colours you've got from red, yellow and blue and see which ones stain more than others, because you will find that will happen. So once it's nice and bone dry, dry with a hairdryer from a distance so you don't burn the paper, try lifting some paint off just by using some kitchen roll, something like that there, and a damp clean brush, not soaking wet though. And see how much of that paint you can take off. Be quite interesting to find out. Because at least then you've got some ideas for when you go to your main subject, which you're painting, whether or not you can actually remove some of that paint. So the next one's going to be Alizarin Crimson. Alizarin Crimson, lovely colour. Look at that. Oh, that's rich. Alizarin Crimson, grab some of that. Don't waste it. Okay, and we're going to go for the French Ultramarine or Ultramarine Blue, anything like that. But can you imagine what this would be like with other blues that you've got within your palette? You know, I'll test another blue out. I'll test out Indigo in a bit as well. A little bit more French Ultramarine. That's quite a warm, warm, kind of deep purple colour. And I'm going to go for Gambo Hue. So which is that one then? They went in the wrong one then. I know what I like. We'll try that one in there. Now that looks like a very deep purple. Yeah, as you can see. So it's not dark, is it? A second layer of that, if I just pop a little bit more there, look how deep that can go. If you have another layer over the top of that. So allow that layer to dry, then add a further layer over the top. And you get a very deep, very, very deep purple colour. Should be quite nice, wouldn't it, as well? So let's go for some more of the French Ultramarine. And we'll try that. Look at that. So that's changed the flavour a little bit more. You can still see that red coming through, can't you? But that's dulled it down. It's cooled it down a little bit. Obviously, French Ultramarine being a cool colour, that really knocks it back. And that is a nice kind of rich, dark colour. I like that one, actually. That's lovely, that. Yeah. And if we add some more of that gamboge hue in there, we'll try that one. That's just dulled it down and lightened that colour up a little bit as well, hasn't it? So there's another combination you can use. So alizarin crimson, French ultramarine or ultramarine blue, whatever one you've got, okay? And also gamboge hue, but make sure you spell gamboge correctly, okay? Okay, next one, alizarin crimson, phthalo green, and phthalo blue. So let's go for the alizarin crimson first, okay? Phthalo green, which is, if I remember rightly, that one there, that's a pink then. Oh, look at that already. Oh, what a rich colour that is. And some phthalo blue. Okay, let's try that one. And look at that. Oh, that's a lovely colour as well. So you can make some lovely blacks by using three different colours, can't you? You really can. I do like that one. Again, it all depends on the subject that you're working with. It really does. Let's cool it down a little bit, shall we? So add some more of the phthalo blue in there. We'll try a little bit more blue and see if it makes a difference. Yep, a slight difference in there. And let's try some more phthalo green in there instead. Let's kind of switch it around. So phthalo green. Oh, just a green tint. Can you imagine working on foliage, something like that? And you got this very deep colour within those contrasts. Yeah, I think that would work really well. So that's working with three colours. And as you can imagine, there's many other combinations out there as well. So try out all your mixing palette that you've got from the tubes and the half pans or full pans, whatever you've got for your watercolour supplies, and see what combinations you can make. What's going to make it really, really dark? Think of that red, yellow and blue. Three fingers, four, not four. Red, yellow and blue. And think about from that term as well, how that tends to work. Or we could look at secondary colours. Pardon? We can look at secondary colours. What do you mean, pardon? What we can do is look at other colours that make those dark colours. So let's say, for example, green, which we know will be blue and yellow, okay? Now, blue and yellow is already that red, yellow and blue combination, isn't it? Those, stay down. Those three different mixes which you can use. So let's already have one that's got two colours already mixed together, blue and yellow, which would be green. So let's try one for the secondary colours and see what we can make. All right, so let's first of all, what should we try? We'll try phthalo green and alizarin crimson. Try that one without getting my hand in all that lovely paint. So phthalo green, let's go for that one there. Look, it's a lovely colour, phthalo green. I keep saying that because a lot of colours are lovely colours, aren't they? They really are. A little bit more. So remember, this is a two mix. So we've already got blue and yellow within there, haven't we, to make the green. So that saved us that job already. All right, so really, really good. And make it again more to a creamy consistency when you're working with this. And then alizarin crimson. So let's just grab some of that out of there. It's all wetted down in there now. I'll mix that. Oh, look at that. Yeah. So that particular one at the moment is like this. So it's like a greeny black colour, isn't it? Really nice indeed. But I'm going to change that a little bit more by adding a little bit more of the alizarin crimson in there, I think. Just get some more. And we'll change that one. So now we've got an even deeper black. Look at that. That's lovely, isn't it? So if we wash our brush out, we'll have a look what that looks like when it's watered down as well. And you can see straight away, look how light that is. It's a nice, rich, dark colour, isn't it? So that's working with phthalo green and then alizarin crimson. Right, viridian green. We'll try that one next and see what happens with that one. And alizarin crimson. Yeah, that's quite still green on there at the moment. So let's just go for a little bit more alizarin crimson in there. So that particular one at the moment is more of a purpley, kind of deep purple colour. Look at that. It's still nice, isn't it? It's a black colour. Very, very rich black colour. Again, this is quite milky consistency at the moment. You really want it thicker than that to make it very, very dark. But sometimes it's wise to go milky first, or even watery sometimes, for like a shadow colour. then gradually increase the consistency of the paint. Okay, so I've just remixed a little bit more, just a small amount of the alizarin crimson there still. So if I just wet that down there, and you see how warm this dark colour is. And again, when you add another layer of that same colour over the top, then you find that lovely colour there will be really, really dark, but it's nice and rich as well. So depends if you want more of the viridian green in there, and you get this colour here. As you can see, that particular colour is a nice kind of deep sort of greeny colour in there compared to when you've got more of the alizarin crimson. So that depends again on the subject that you're painting, of course. Okay, Payne's Grey and Burnt Umber. We'll try that one. Now, the thing with Payne's Grey is that we know it's a cool, dark colour, isn't it? So very cool. And it's really handy for kind of shadowed areas as well. But when you mix it with Burnt Umber, then that can warm that colour up. So it's working with both kind of cool and warm colours at the same time. But when you do test this out, try variations of it as well. And because you can add a little bit more Payne's Grey or a little bit more Burnt Umber into the mix, so it depends on which way you want to kind of go, either hot or cold. Entirely up to you, really, of course. But I do find that the Payne's Grey and Burnt Umber, probably a 50-50 mix, works really well for some of those dark, earthy tones. So well worth having to play with these two colours and see what you can do with that. So the more watery the paint is, the more suitable that will be for those shadow areas as well. And then we've got French ultramarine and burnt sienna. I know, I thought I would just write the whole word ultramarine for a change. Yeah, it's a bit long, isn't it? Okay, right, here we go. So French ultramarine. Now, French ultramarine is one of those colours which is granulating. I find it kind of granulates quite a lot. I suppose it depends on the make of the paint as well. And because it granulates, what will happen is it could part company from the other colour. Let's get a little bit more of that in there, actually. Burnt sienna. So when you leave it within the mixing well for a period of time, it will start to part company. You can see that, actually, from the first mix, which included ultramarine blue, or French ultramarine in my case, within there. And you can see the differences in colours around the outside, can't you, on there? I know, it does make a massive difference. So this is just those two colours at the moment. The burnt sienna is a lovely warm colour. And depends on how much of each colour you add, again, will depend on the outcome of that dark colour. But look at that, that's a lovely colour, isn't it? And that's more of a milky consistency at the moment. So that's French ultramarine and burnt sienna, and you can see the way that this all works together. And again, the more burnt sienna you add, the warmer that colour will be. So French ultramarine, burnt sienna, also known as Jane's Grey. Okay, we're going to go for French ultramarine and burnt umber next. Now this is a mix I do sometimes use, actually, because it's quite a nice combination. Also gives you a nice, very cool grey as well. And you can see, again, it's a little bit different to the rest of them. We've got the really warm colours at the moment, haven't we, on the top there. But that's a nice kind of deep sort of bluey black. Try that. So this will have more of a brown hint to it now. Try that one more. So I like the way they can go from cool to dark, you really can. And the burnt umber is just another sort of warm colour we can use just to darken it down a little bit more. So that's with the burnt umber more dominant in that side compared to the French ultramarine. Okay, I'm going to do one last one with you now. And this time it's going to be indigo and burnt umber. Now, indigo is one of those nice, cool colours I've used for years. It really is a lovely colour. But sometimes you want to warm that one as well. So let's just try that one a minute. A little bit more burnt umber, maybe. This is just the indigo, okay, with a tiny amount of burnt umber in it. And that's just changed it a small amount, as you can see. But still more on a blue side, isn't it, as you can see there. So back to the burnt umber, and we'll top that one in there. We'll add that one in there as well. Let's just try that now and see what we get. So this has warmed that indigo up a little bit, hasn't it? As you can see here, look how deep that is there. It's a very deep colour, isn't it? Oh, I like that, actually. And we'll try that one. And you can see the warmth within that side compared to the coolness of this side here. Look how warm this is in comparison. So when you look at a two-colour mix, as I say, you've got to think about that red, red, yellow, and blue for those three different colours you're going to work with. So they're your primary mixes. So if you've got colours where you've already got two colours already combined, so say, for example, if you've got red and blue to make purple, so you're going to use a purple with yellow, okay, for two colours, purple with yellow, but that should also make a dark colour. But you have to keep it more of a creamy consistency. So this is the second layer. I've just done this all the way over the top of these, as you can see, using each individual mix. And look how dark these colours are. Very dark. And that's just using the two colour mix. So really good. So when you look at the colours I've made here from my own half pan collection, it's going to give us some ideas just to begin with, on how many dark colours, both cool and obviously warm. So you don't always have to use a pre-made black like my lamp black here. Or paints grey to some degree as well. I mean, I do use both paints, as you know, lamp black in there, paints grey in there. But look at the variation of colours you can make by just going through your selection of half pans or tube paints that you've got within your painting kit. Now, what colours do you like to use to make your really dark mixes? Let me know in the comments down below. Now, I tend to fill my half pan paints up using tube paints. Really? I know I do. Now, I've made a little video on how I tend to fill these up, because it's not just a matter of just squeezing some paint in those half pan blocks. Okay, let me give some ideas what I mean in that video to the right. I'll see you there.